Hello, everybody. Exist Kind. An Exist Kind investigates all the ways we could, can, and do exist more harmoniously with each other and our environment. And tonight, I have Beryl Baker, and she is running for Ward 1 to be our next council person. So, Beryl, please, introduce yourself to those who may not know you as well as they would like to yet.
Okay. Of course, I'm Beryl Baker, and I'm not a politician, nor am I a glib speaker. However, people that have worked with me have find me a reflective, thoughtful problem solver. It is in my nature to seek out and listen to all sides before making a studied decisions on issues. And I believe it's important to incorporate all concerns of all facets of our community in designing a brighter future for our city.
Very, very good. I like the sound of that. But tell me, what really made you decide to run for office?
When Mayor Volge was in office, the City Council had a vision, and they were leading toward a sustainable future. Right now, they don't appear to have a vision of what needs to change in order for Tucson to prepare for even greater economic problems and environmental potential crashes. World-known Lester Brown has traveled the world trying to help nations prepare for and attempt to prevent failed states. We need to follow his advice to produce jobs, save money, reduce our energy footprint, attract new industries, and build a stronger economy for Tucson's future. We don't need more government, we need smarter government. So you might say, I believe I have seen a vision that we need to follow, and by being part of City Council, I will bring together all members of the community to move toward solving problems.
Very good. You know, I just got this thing when you tell me stuff, I really agree with so much of it. But I want you to help me out a little bit. And I understand it, but I don't think I understand it as much as I would like to. I know it's there, but I don't know to the level that I should about this good old boy politics, or good old boy, good old gal. Help me out a little bit with this. Help me understand this, what this good old boy problem is and how it's harming us.
Okay. My perception of good old boys is backroom deals. Deals made in private. For example, the Rio Nuevo, after they got the funds for it, all of a sudden they changed its direction. And they also extended the corridor of the Rio Nuevo all the way down past Elkhorn out to Park Mall, which was the people who had gotten the funds and et cetera, they were like appalled. It's like, we made all sorts of promises and now you've changed everything. So they were very concerned about that. It's damaged it because we have gone down a path of unsustainable water use. It's been growth at any cost. The RTA is an example of that, where there's hundreds of small businesses that are going to be affected and may potentially put out of business on Grant Road. There are some good RTA projects,
right,
but there are some like the Grant Road one, which is going to harm our economy. And then, of course, we all know about the $230 million waste that's being investigated by the FBI.
Wow. And yes, I have heard all those on the on the news. And it just overwhelms me, the amount of money we wasted just thinking about Rio Nuevo. And I don't know the numbers, but I just remember that they were really, really high. And I was shocked. I just can't believe they did that. You know, it just definitely shocks me. But, you know, I've noticed that you're in a very interesting place. I think that you are somebody who can appeal to both Democratic and Republican voters. I've been talking to you. Mm-hmm. And that's my feel about the whole thing. I think that you're the kind of a person who, and we need that right now. I think that the more moderate Democrats and the more moderate Republicans, I think those are people that you might be able to really appeal to. But tell me a little bit more. What would you do? How would you go along that that path of satisfying both Republicans and Democrats?
Well, the long and short of it is bringing them together. But I've talked to a lot of Republicans and I've talked to Democrats, and I have found that the ones who really want to move forward are willing to take the labels off of Republican, Democrat, Greens. They're willing to start listening to each other and talking to each other and trying to solve the problems. And that's where I feel I have a great deal of strength, because my concept is to take the labels off of people so that they can come together as just people and understanding people. And until we do that, mm-hmm. we're never going to solve the problems until we start working together.
So I just can totally see you able to find the common ground that we all have, mm-hmm. and then sorting out the differences and coming up with a working plan. In a minute, we're going to go to talking about No Labels. We have a musician for this show, and it's Rudy Cortez, and he doesn't have a label, and he's going to sing for us. So in a moment, he's going to do just that. But what I want to let you know what we're going to talk about in just a moment and begin to now is a little bit more about how could we have prevented the Rio Nuevo debacle? What could we have done to prevent that?
Well, it's my opinion that we should have had no backroom deals. We should have had more budget oversight, and I think a lot of people agree to that. And the city council should have been more aware. They should have learned the project, been observant of what was happening. They should have had a clearer vision. And they should have been avoiding pie-in-the-sky deals, like the hotel. Developers, they go out when they're going to do something, they go out and do marketing, and they figure out whether it's going to work or whether it's not going to work, whether it's feasible, whether it's not feasible. If they think it's going to be feasible, they'll do the project, and they don't necessarily ask for government funds to do that. When people have a pot of money, like we did with Rio Nuevo, mm-hmm. everybody wants a pot of that money. But it has to be used more effectively for real results. And one of the things they didn't do is they gave away, or they did do, which was not right, mm-hmm. is they gave away land for next to nothing, like $100 for the thrifty talk of the town, which nothing has happened there. I mean, that's outrageous. Then we have the city saying we don't have the budget, and yet they give away the land that they have in order to have money. That doesn't make much sense.
They give it away for a fraction of its value.
A fraction? I mean, $100 for something that's worth...
I'm having a hard time processing that, but I did hear about it, and it was just so bizarre, I blew it off. It's like, I thought it was just some kind of whatever, but
But they're still doing it. I mean, they just recently, for a fraction of its cost, sold land on the west side of the freeway mm-hmm. to a developer
right.
who turned around and made a huge profit on it.
You know, I'm hoping that this isn't the case, but I've heard about things like this being kind of like ways to make money, underhanded things sometimes, selling land for a small amount of money and the developer makes a whole lot of money and then something happens to where everybody, it couldn't possibly be that though, but it sure sounds like it. It sure puts you in a position where somebody could paint that picture, doesn't it?
It does sound that way. And what I've heard is they say that if we give away the land and they build something, then they get the taxes back and they eventually make back what they would have lost. Mm-hmm. And that may be true in some cases, mm-hmm. but for instance, the one downtown where they've done nothing and the city actually paid to demolish the buildings and still nothing has happened.
The whole thing's been kind of like a money sieve the last few years, hasn't it?
It appears that way.
It's here, just it a huge money sieve.
And then we hear they've been paid, the consultants have been paid huge, huge sums for plans that never happened that are sitting on the shelf. And then they make huge plans, and some of the projects they do are actually cost less to do than the consulting. And you're scratching your head and you're wondering, okay.
Right, exactly. That's the one that really makes me scratch my head. I just cannot get my head around how anybody or why anybody would do that unless they're just paying their friends or something. I don't know. It's kind of, I'm not going to say that because, you know, you just never know. I would give people the benefit of the doubt. But still, I mean, it just puts them in a position where people can make those kinds of accusations, and sometimes I wonder. Well, we're going to take a little break right now and listen to some of that music that Rudy has to play. So anytime we're ready, my control people will put that music up for us. You're going to love it. It's Rudy Cortez, and I've had him.
Can't you hear that bird crying? Oh, can't you hear that lonesome dove singing? Won't you come back, darling? Long time.